Hello everyone, and welcome to the St. Louis Art Museum's Art Speaks program. My name is Jessica Kennedy, and I'm the educator for adult learning at the museum. Before we begin, please familiarize yourself with the Q&A section located on your screen. Feel free to enter your questions at any time during the program, and we will choose a few to answer at the end. Also, there is live auto transcription available for this program. Please click the CC icon to activate or deactivate the subtitles. For today's talk, Inspiration, Preservation, Appropriation, a conversation about collecting Central European folk textiles, we are joined by three speakers: Genny Cortinovis, the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation Associate Curator of Decorative Arts and Design; Megan Brandow-Faller, Professor of History at City University of New York, Kingsborough at the City University of New York; and St. Louis collector Marvin Moehle. Now, to get us started, I'm going to turn things over to Genny. Thanks, Genny.
Hi, welcome. I assume there are some friendly faces out there. So again, thanks so much for joining us today for this session of Art Speaks. It dovetails with an exhibition that we have in the galleries right now in our devoted textile gallery, Gallery 100. And this is an exhibition called Fabricating Empire, Folk Textiles in the Making of Early 20th Century Austrian Design. And that is on view until May 28th. So if you get a chance, we definitely encourage you to come to the museum to see it. So I am so happy to welcome my two guests today. First, Megan Brandow-Faller. She is a fantastic professor and scholar of turn of the century Austrian design. Her research focuses on art and design in secessionist and interwar Vienna, including children's art and artistic toys of the Vienna secession, expressionist ceramics of the Vienna Werkstätte, folk art and modernism, which is the subject of today's talk, and women's art education. She is the editor of Childhood by Design, Toys and the Material Culture of Childhood, 1700 to Present, the co-editor of Erasures and Eradications and Viennese Modern Art, Architecture and Design, and the author of a number of really fascinating articles and book chapters. So welcome, Professor Brandow-Faller. We are so happy to have you. We also have with us Marvin E. Moehle. He is a Granite City-based collector of Central, Southern, and Eastern European folk costume. By some accounts, Marvin, I think you have more than 1,000 costumes, and certainly tens of thousands of textiles associated with those. So we are just really thrilled to have you here. And without your generosity, we couldn't have had this exhibition, because the St. Louis Art Museum does not have actually a collection of folk costume that rivals in any way, shape, or form yours. So thank you so much for all of your generous loans to the exhibition and your generosity in kind of sharing all of your knowledge and experience and stories as well. And we'll have some of those today. So without further ado, I'm gonna pass the torch to Megan, and then we'll have a kind of conversation with Marvin to follow up.
Thank you so much, Genny, for this invitation. I was delighted to be invited. There could not be an exhibition or event that is more like the themes of my work. I think this is an amazing exhibition, an amazing collection. So just so you know, as we get started today, my talk is going to be more historically based, and I'll give an overview of the Vienna Modern's interest in folk art and how that specifically influenced some of the work in the Vienna workshops. And then I'm going to look at one particular flashpoint where folk costume was literally on parade: the 1908 Emperor Homage Parade. Okay, so the late 19th century represented a rising critical tide of interest in folk art and house industry objects in Austria-Hungary. Through a system of imperial design schools, Viennese curators promoted folk art as a repository of previously undiscovered ornamental forms and techniques. Increasingly after 1900, the pre-existing 19th century interest in folk art became tethered to the authenticity, originality, and raw crudeness that was associated with the art of other so-called primitive peoples. Now, as we will see in this conversation today about appropriation, there was at once the specific visual influences of folk art the actual visual influences, as well as the idea of appropriating the discursive field, the ideas surrounding folk art. And these two sources of influence were, connected and not mutually exclusive. The Vienna Secessionist and Klimt group were able to study folk art at events such as the 1905-1906 exhibition of Austrian folk art and house industry. It was a huge, comprehensive exhibition of folk art held at the Austrian Museum of Applied Art, as well as events like the 1908 Emperor Homage Parade, which was a costumed historical spectacle that was designed and executed by modernist artists. Now, there were two parts to the parade, a history section that represented the history of the Habsburg dynasty, and then secondly, and importantly to the themes of today, folk delegations from the provinces wearing folk costume from their respective homelands. The parade's folk delegations reenacted peasant life and celebrations like weddings, harvest festivals, and hunting processions, and were similar, a sort of living version of the ethnographic villages that were standard at world's fairs. But first, this will be our focus, this 1908 Emperor Homage Parade. I want to give you just a little bit of an overview of the influence of folk art on the Wiener Werkstätte and Austrian modernism in general. Folk art was a critical source of influence for Viennese expressionism and exercised an especially potent influence on the textiles and fashions of the famed Vienna workshops or Wiener Werkstätte. Around 1910, the Wiener Werkstätte began producing designs for printed textiles. And many of these designs featured stylized floral motifs that were informed by Austrian and Hungarian folk embroidery. We see this here in Josef Hoffmann's 1910 bellflower carpet design, shown in the center, which reinterprets folk embroidery from his native Bohemia, particularly in the linear division of space and the stylized bellflower motifs. Josef Hoffmann's 1911 textile design Apollo likewise featured stylized versions of a tulip embroidery motifs. And I think this forms a very fitting logo for the current exhibition. Much like this example, the Wiener Werkstätte became famous for its block printed fabrics that inflected the colors and patterns of folk art, but superimposed with Viennese modernist aesthetics. In countless examples, it was female designers that experimented with contemporary movements like expressionism, cubism, and abstraction, all the while reinterpreting folk art. They made a forceful statement that craft could think through contemporary movements in a similar manner as the fine arts. This printed silk textile by Lotte Frommer shows the artist filtering her influence in folk art through expressionist design principles, in that the black ground of the textile resembles the roughly hewn lines of an expressionist woodblock print. The influence of folk art on other textile designs could be more indirect and abstract. Take this example by Maria Lichardt Strauss. She was one of the most prolific textile designers for the Wiener Werkstätte. And we see the textile design Irland or Ireland, which is shown as a backdrop for a fashion postcard. Maria Lichardt Strauss was credited with nearly 200 textile designs during her two-decade career at the Wiener Werkstätte from 1912 to 1932. And as we can see, reinterpreted folk art in perhaps a more abstract way. Composed of abstract geometrical elements, her 1910 textile design, Ireland or Ireland, anticipated developments in contemporary painting by decades. Another example of a more abstract interpretation of the vernacular by designer Mariana Perlmutter. As the names Ireland and Zakopane suggest, the names of textile designs sometimes evoke sort of these exotic frontiers, sometimes within the monarchy. Zakopane was a region in Southeast Galicia that was famous for its vernacular building traditions and was famously rediscovered by Polish intellectuals in the late 19th century as a repository of undiscovered authentic folk art. In some more rarer examples, textile designs could actually be informed by the folk art of the regions that they reference. For instance, Hoffmann's Ragusa design was actually named after the Dalmatian city of Ragusa, which is present-day Dubrovnik, and is reminiscent of the diamond motif of South Slavic rugs, objects that he would have seen on view at the important 1905 exhibition of folk art, which you can see here. So largely informed by folk art. In the interwar Wiener Werkstätte, a remarkable cross-pollination flowed between high and low forms of expression. Wiener Werkstätte textiles were informed by folk art, just as they were informed by expressionistic currents. And these folk art-informed textiles even made their way onto the backdrops of Gustav Klimt's canvases. So the first part of my talk, I've tried to go over a few specific influences of folk art on Viennese modernism and the Wiener Werkstätte. And for the rest of the talk, I want to transition into talking about one particular flashpoint for folk art on the Vienna moderns, and that's this 1908 Emperor homage parade, where folk art was literally on parade. The 1908 Emperor homage parade was a costumed historical spectacle that was informed by living history ethnographic displays. The parade dramatized the monarchy's present by juxtaposing scenes of dynastic history with its contemporary peasantry represented in the Parade of Nations. So here we see the distinct regional costume of Salzburg, contrasted with a scene from the double wedding of the emperor, of the grandchildren of the Emperor Maximilian. Upwards of a half million spectators lined Vienna's Ring Boulevard or Ringstrasse to behold the spectacle that was designed to exceed previous imperial celebrations. Journalists were struck by the parade's dreamlike, surreal quality, past and present, theater and reality, the authentic and the copy merged as costume performers mingled with streetgoers. Somehow this was very Viennese. The night before the parade, Viennese daily newspaper, the Neue Freie Presse, reported that Rudolf I, the founder of the Habsburg dynasty, had gone missing during rehearsals in the Prater. Rudolf, who was actually played by Count Eltz, had apparently stepped out of character for a beer. A striking number of the parade's real historical figures were played by their real descendants, sometimes eponymous descendants, which only compounded the parade's sort of surreal mixture of reality and fantasy. But even more popular than the history section were the folk delegations from the monarchies, from throughout the monarchy. And especially from its eastern and southern sort of Rheinbezirk in German, the border regions, who were idealized for their exotic, even primitive folk costumes. So here we see a delegation from Iglau. And to imagine what this parade might have looked like to contemporary onlookers, I think it might be revealing to compare this delegation with some of the costumes on view in the exhibition, this folk costume from Southern Bohemia. Discovering folk art as an untainted, authentic source of artistic vitality were the artists of the Klimt group and Vienna secession. Now, these were the same individuals who were responsible for designing and executing the parade's historical section. Visualized in its sets, costumes, and graphic arts, secessionist artists grafted modernist design principles onto an idealized version of folk art and dynastic history and peasant life. Naturally, it was divorced from the politics of the nationality question of the present. So the parade presented 19 historical groups, or sort of living pictures, tableaux, from the history of the dynasty. It began with the history of the dynasty in 1273 and ended with the military triumphs of the Field Marshal Radetzky from the very beginning of the Emperor Franz Joseph's reign. Now, problematically, the more controversial events of the more recent past were omitted. The first group of the history section of the parade represented a homage procession to Rudolf I, the same guy who stepped out for a beer, who was the first Habsburg elected to the office of Holy Roman Emperor in 1273. Now, quite strikingly, you can see him looking off to this sort of stage right. He was shown to be paying homage to his present day descendant, the Emperor Franz Joseph, who was looking on in the imperial viewing stands. Demonstrating the parade's bizarre mixture of reality and fantasy, Rudolf's military retinue was made up of leading members of Austria's most ancient noble houses, often playing their own historical ancestors and sometimes clad in actual medieval armor or copies thereof. Now, there's much more to say on the history section, but obviously I've chosen to focus on the folk art themes today. The historical groups were counterpointed by folk delegations from the Crownland. They processed in order of their appearance in the emperor's title and paid homage in their mother tongue. Now, they were dressed in traditional folk costume, and the 8,000 participants vastly outnumbered the 4,000 actors in the history section. To many critics, the folk delegations lacked the theatricality and sense of inauthenticity that was conveyed by the historical section. The one Viennese daily newspaper held that the historical section paled in comparison to the picturesque splendor of the quote-unquote full-blooded folk cultures. So the delegations reenacted peasant life. This group from Cernovitz, for instance, reenacted a hunting procession. And with regard to the notion of folk art on parade, they were sort of a walking version of the peasant villages that were sort of standard in the culture of 19th century world's fairs. Like these gold and silver costumes from Dalmatia, it was the monarchy's most distant, exotic folk cultures, the sort of colonial frontiers of the empire, if you will, that most gripped the spectators of the parade. Secessionist critics like Ludwig Havesi praised folk art as an undiscovered wellspring of artistic vitality, represented the authenticity that the historical sections lacked. He called the folk delegations a promenading ethnographic museum. So to show you some folk costume from the same region as this delegation from Dalmatia, we can look at this stunning Croatian women's ensemble that's on view in the exhibition now. So modernist critics look to folk art as this positive source for revitalizing contemporary art and design. Differing, however, with secessionist critics like Ludwig Havesi was the anti-secessionist critic Karl Kraus. Karl Kraus was not a fan of the parade in general. He coined his own name for the festivities. He called it a triumphal parade of sycophancy. Now, he was famous for his satirical journal, The Torch. in English. So in his satirical journal, he ran an acerbic column that parodied the patriotic coverage of the parade by the Neue Freie Presse and other leading daily newspapers. So to clarify, the Neue Freie Presse ran a daily column on parade happenings called the parade 3 months in advance of the event. And the whole newspaper was about the parade, essentially. So despite its supposedly mass audience and supranational political aims, he believed that the overrepresentation of nobility donning treasures from their own collections told a very different story. But most importantly, to the theme of folk art, he had a very different opinion of folk art than, say, the likes of Havasi. In his longest essay on the parade, he polemicized against the abject ugliness and supposedly uncivilized appearance of the folk delegations. To Krauss, the parade's overrepresentation of peoples from the most distant, quote unquote, primitive Eastern crownlands only perpetuated notions of Austrian backwardness. Now, this situation was largely resulting from the financial incentives offered to participants by the planners. As a result, Austria's most advanced, more central, the more industrially developed provinces were underrepresented, and the poorer, less developed Eastern provinces were more strongly represented. Recounting a chance run-in with members of the contingent from Iglau, Krauss remembered distinctly, quote, unhandsome farmers with weather-beaten skin, and old nannies with faces so horrific that the lifelong bachelor feared for his potential future children. His hyperbolic account of the folk delegation's ugliness suggested that the empire's quote-unquote primitive folk cultures were entirely out of place in the modern metropolis and had even less in common with the parade's dynastic history section. To Krauss, the Habsburg past seemed entirely irrelevant to Austria's uncertain multinational present, which, in his view, needed to embrace modern urban progress and not vernacular backwardness. So to the avant-garde, folk costumes signified timeless, unchanging peasant customs that were feared to be in danger of extinction and should be preserved. But within the value system of late 19th century world's fairs, folk art could also be read as manifesting a colonialist, racialized hierarchy over which Austro-German culture reigned supreme. This value system was apparent, for instance, at the 1873 Vienna World's Fair. There, exhibits of high culture, science, and industry were juxtaposed with picturesque living history displays of peasant life. Again, these displays were not unlike the parade. So the late 19th century exhibitionary complex necessarily cast the most distant crownlands, those that most captivated the parade spectators, as colonial backwaters at the bottom of an unacknowledged caste system over which Austro-German culture reigned supreme. Critical links between the parade's mission to establish celebratory linkages between past and present, urban center and agrarian periphery can be found in group 13 of the history section, the only tableau from the history section to deal with folk art. And it was called Country Harvest and Wine Festival from the era of the Emperor Joseph II. The float was staged by leading Klimt group member Bertolt Loeffler, who engaged students like Oskar Kokoschka and Rudolf Kalvach to design it and appear in it as actors. So in contrast to the value system of 19th century world's fairs, Loeffler and his students prized folk art for the objectivity of vision, creative spontaneity, and expressive immediacy that urban civilization had buried. part and parcel of the broader cult of the primitive. The untutored peasant was thought to embody a sort of domestic noble savage at a similar stage of evolutionary development as children. Folk art, folk culture was believed to be supposedly uncorrupted by civilization and the values of the marketplace. So here we see two scenes from the actual parade, this modernist reinterpretation of folk art and folk costume, and this moment from the parade showing these actors, young art students, reenacting a country dance from a wine festival. Not only of aesthetic interest, the role of folk art in the monarchy's socioeconomic future had been the subject of intense scrutiny since the 1870s. Members of the Vienna School of Art History promoted folk art as a positive source for revitalizing contemporary industry and handcraft. They presented folk art as a corrective to the parade of historicist revival styles preceding it. And design reformers hoped that the dissemination of folk art patterns in an empire-wide system of craft schools might not only revitalize house industry in certain underdeveloped regions, but also contribute to the formation of a supranational design aesthetic that would synthesize diverse national ethnic vernaculars into something running broader and deeper than nationality. Such a project, stressing folk art's common origins, would support, they believed, the monarchy's continued political viability by neutralizing efforts to claim regional folk art as indexing particular ethnic traditions. So I would be very curious to hear the second part of the talk and to hear about certain commonalities between folk arts of different regions, because that was what these art historians were debating, among other things. So we have the 19th century interest in folk art as a positive source for revitalizing contemporary art and design. And then simultaneously, a younger generation of artists born in the 1870s rediscovered folk art and tethered it to the primitive, apparently timeless and unchanging, formal qualities associated with the art of tribal peoples. And that has been the thrust of a lot of my work, pointing to this phenomenon of primitivism in the Viennese context, how that influenced Vienna Vexta to textiles, early Viennese expressionism, and so on. Appearing 14 years before the parade was a very important study of folk art by the famous Viennese art historian Alois Riegel. So his 1894 study on folk art polemicized against the contemporary fixation with folk art, this folk art movement. Riegel famously likened the contemporary fixation with folk art to a drink of pure spring water by a champagne glutton who was sick of his rich cuisine. In his study, Riegel defined folk art and house industry in rigorous economic terms. And he contended that true folk art was only that was produced in the home for daily use or ceremonial use in the home. So he called this Hausfleiß, or domestic labor. Anything that was produced for the market to be used outside of the home, he did not count as true folk art. So by his definition, house industry was not folk art. By this definition, Riegel would have excluded some of the folk costumes and artifacts in the parade. Riegel stridently opposed efforts to preserve or revitalize folk art through expanded commercial distribution networks, because he believed such efforts to artificially preserve house industry did little to advance peripheral regions like Galicia or the Bukovina, given that he necessarily believed that folk art was the product of economic or cultural backwardness. Ultimately, Riegel predicted that his overly civilized champagne drinker would ultimately become tired of folk art, find the pure waters of folk art boring, and once again crave something spicier. So it is interesting to interpret the reinterpretation of folk art by the Vienna moderns in this context. In the 1908 parade, Group 13 presented onlookers with an idealized version of a harvest festival from the era of the Emperor Joseph II. Its idealized peasant mania inverted the values typically associated with primitive folk cultures, even as it continued to perpetuate colonialist attitudes towards the periphery. The contested political legacy of this group's namesake, the Emperor Joseph II, would have loomed large among the onlookers to the parade. So Joseph II was a late 18th century enlightened emperor who was variously claimed by liberals, by German nationalists, and other groups. He abolished serfdom in certain regions in the monarchy. He promoted religious toleration and also promoted centralized German language reform. So his image would have loomed large to parade spectators. But Loeffler and his students were less concerned with depicting real historical peasants than loosely reinterpreting folk costume through the lens of their own aesthetic values. They investigated the manner in which the rural noble savage was conceptualized in the tradition of 18th century luminaries like Rousseau, who idealized the peasantry precisely because of its authentic and unspoiled freshness. So Group 13 took conceptual inspiration from the folk art artifacts and thematic subject matter of the folk delegations. Leading the group were 50 costume musicians, followed by a massive harvest wagon decorated with poppies and cornflowers, and surrounded by festively dressed harvesters. The Viennese daily newspaper, the Neue Freie Presse, joked that the wagon's most precious cargo was the comely peasant girls on top, about whom little was peasant-like aside from the colorfulness of their clothing, which bordered on the secessionist. A mood of health, prosperity, and youthful vitality clung to the entire group. In conjunction with the parade, there were postcards designed by Wiener Werkstätte artists to commemorate the event, which captured its musicians and peasants using summery planes of color and a simplified, almost childlike linearity. So in conclusion, and as a way of wrapping up, parade artists expressed an elective affinity with the folk cultures of the 1908 homage parade as a means of strategically rejecting the historicist aesthetics that found a high point in the neo-historicist Ringstrasse. Conflated with the arts of tribal peoples and children, the supposedly timeless ahistorical folk art on parade in 1908, represented the climax of the Klimt group's search for new formal sources. What Klimt called true or primitive art, a new frontier in our own homeland. So I will stop there and hand the torch back to Genny. And just as a sort of disclaimer, just let me say that my talk today comes from a much longer study. So I'm very open to questions, comments, etc. Thank you so much for this invitation.
Thank you so much, Megan. That was fantastic. That was really just such a rich and complicated account of the relationship between Viennese modernism and folk art, and the really strange and fascinating Emperor Homage Parade, which I think we can agree was really, it's almost as fascinating for who decided not to participate in the fair than who did. So maybe we can kind of get into that in a minute.
I'm so glad you brought that up because of the boycotts. I didn't you know, I didn't.
Yeah. And I mean, that speaks to the burgeoning nationalism, right? Yeah. And the sort of territorial fragmentation that's happening at the time. Yeah. So one through line I really see between this exploration is the concept of kind of shifting centers and peripheries, and how as these objects travel from rural to regional centers to imperial capitals, and then from Central Europe itself to communities really across the world, but especially in the United States, we see how their meaning changes. And I think, you know, we can see kind of this representation or this exploration of the kind of problematic other, right? Or this as complicated, but also, you know, as these objects were also a vehicle for belonging and for building histories and communities elsewhere. So at the same time that they're sort of seen as something that's apart, other people are seeing them as a way to belong, as a way to participate and kind of chart history. So I think we'll get into that shortly with Marvin. And I think especially Marvin can speak to this notion of folk art not being timeless in that sense, not being ahistorical, right? But as a living, breathing practice, how these costumes change. And I think especially with some of the later objects, Marvin, which you could speak to, about how they are not untouched by industry, they're not untouched by urbanization, and they're certainly not untouched by the marketplace, even when they were made, some of them in the late 19th century to today. So I think that actually gives a really nice segue to kind of as a, almost as a counterpoint to some of these ideas that were happening at the turn of the century. So without further ado, I will bring up my screen so we can see some of these beautiful objects. Okay, so Marvin, I just wanted the very general question of sort of how did you begin collecting?
Well, I started collecting in the late 1970s. There was a woman in my neighborhood in Granite City, Illinois. It was an immigrant neighborhood, and she was from Macedonia. And she, when we had show and tell, when I was in grade school, we had show and tell, and I knew she had this fantastic wedding costume that was just amazing, all hand embroidered, hand spun. I mean, it was really amazing. So I would go to her house and I would say, you know, Grandma Tasa, can I borrow your wedding clothes? And she would say, sure, I'm having show and tell at school. So she'd bundle him up in a great big bag. I'd put him over on my shoulder. I'd walk to school several blocks and I would take him out. And because my grandparents were born in Macedonia, it was part of my heritage. So I had a really sense of pride in showing our national folk costume. So then I started talking to the immigrants in the neighborhood and collecting oral histories and asking them about the folk costume in their area. And I asked my grandmother, why don't you have a costume like Grandma Tasa's costume? And she said, because in our part in Macedonia, the freedom fighters said that we could no longer waste our time on embroidery. We had to start wearing French style clothing, which was more modern style, like Little House on the Prairie dresses in 1903. So the costume in our area was abandoned. And Baba Tasa's area, where she was from, Grandma Tasa, where she was from, they kept their traditional clothing until like after World War I. So, and then she said, whenever she died, she wanted me to have her folk costume, her bridal dress. So the day came, she died. Her daughter came to me and brought the costume to me. And I said, you need to ask everyone in the family, all the grandkids, if they want the costume. This is a family heirloom. It needs to stay in the family. So she asked all the grandkids, and there was one granddaughter that wanted to keep the costume. But the daughter found another almost complete costume that she had also made that was given to me for my collection. So that summer I went to Macedonia and I collected the remaining pieces to make mine complete. And so that was the very first costume that I got as part of my collection. And then I had some pen pals in Czechoslovakia, as it was called at that time. And I went to visit them and we became really close, great friends. And they informed me that they wanted to defect because they were unhappy with the communist government. They wanted to defect. And at that time when I was there, I was able to purchase a few costumes. When they defected in about 1980, Mittig and Magda Schultz was their name, with their two little daughters, they brought to me this Kiev costume, this little girl's costume that you see pictured complete. And it's really interesting because it has a lot of protective features. For instance, you know, there's little bitty wolf's teeth at the bottom embroidered, and that's for protection for, you know, evil. There's a lot of symbolism on these costumes, which are really, really nice.
So I love the story behind this costume too, because it was first I should say one of the great aspects of your collection is the fact that you've actually documented the histories and the provenance of many of these works. And so this one is interesting because it comes, you kind of know not exactly who made it, but the context in which it was made. Mm-hmm. So this one was made, modeled after an adult costume made for a folk dance group.
Yes, that's correct.
And it was, the folk dance group was actually created by a really influential choreographer who studied with Isadora Duncan and who was interested in kind of modern dance, but also, you know, Moravian folk dance. And so it was kind of part of this revival. And this one is dated on the skirt here, 1947, which is really, really interesting. I think, one thing I found, Marvin, when I was looking at this in comparison to some earlier costumes too, was just the way that the design had kind of been stamped on rather than tie-dyed.
Yes, that was very traditional for this area, that they would stamp the design on the material, and it's almost like a plastic sheen. It looks plastic, but it's a really old art form. And then after that, they do the embroidery on top of that. And even the adult costumes have the same thing on the aprons.
That's really beautiful. So why did you decide to continue collecting folk costumes? Sort of what drew you in?
Well, you know, no two costumes are alike. So I'm constantly learning about costumes and getting more and more information. In some cases, like in northern Bulgaria, there's a group of people called the Vlach people. And I probably have 10 or more costumes from that one village. And each costume has really distinctive differences. And, you know, the differences with the costumes are like, you know, you could tell if it's a bridal costume. Not only that, it's like how wealthy she is, how talented she is at the embroidery work. There's special clan designs, there's protective elements. For instance, the color red was considered to ward off the evil eye. The shininess of, you know, sequins, of other things like that, is again a protective thing. This costume that's on the screen now is from Vlata, and I purchased that when I was there visiting my pen pals. And the lady was really proud. She brought it back to me and she said, I removed all the metal sequins and I put brand new shiny ones on, which was kind of like, oh, too bad, but that's okay. You know, the whole costume was, you know, restored, and it's in beautiful shape. The headpiece is for a married woman, and it's pretty rare itself.
Have an account of her making the costume, right?
Yes. And this costume, actually, the lady had purchased a book, and the book actually showed all the patterns, the embroidery patterns, and how to cut it out, all the details. And she also gave me the book with the costume, so I have that. And then I would write to these people, and I would ask them details. They would send me old pictures of them in the costumes. And I really want to get the history of the costume. You know, who made it, why they made it, how it was worn. For me, that's really important.
This one, I was fascinated because in the letter that you gave me about her, Anna Simakova-Mixkovska's kind of account of how she made the costume, she also calls it a national costume because this is made to celebrate the end of the Habsburg Empire. really the end of the monarchy and the kind of birth of the nation in 1919. So I love that. I think how people call what sort of, you know, terminology they use to describe, you know, whether regional dress, folk costume, national costume, vernacular dress, all these things kind of shift and tell us a little bit about what these objects mean to them.
Yes, when I would go into the village and would talk to the older people about their clothing, they would say, at first I would use the word costume or costume, and they would say like, oh yes, you know, I have a costume, and they would show me something like I'm wearing now. The costume is something you wear when you're trying to be someone that you're not, basically. So they usually don't use the word costume. My grandmother, even though she wore modern clothes as a child, French style clothing, she would call these things village clothing, or they would call it our clothes, our clothing. And my grandmother, because you know she was in modern clothes, she was very proud that she was very progressive, and so she would like laugh at people that wore this stuff. She's probably turning over in her grave now that she's, you know, that looking at my big collection of traditional folk clothing. This is a blouse, a neck piece, and a bridal cap from Pešťany in Slovakia. And again, I purchased this when I was in Czechoslovakia, as it was called at that time. And it has metal threads. So I was told that it's a very old, early example because of the metal threads inside in the embroidery.
It's really, really beautiful. While researching the exhibition, one of the kind of interesting things is that Koloman Moser, who's one of the co-founders of the Wiener Werkstätte, he has a very large collection of Slovakian embroidery. And some of it is from, I always call it Pěštany, which is embarrassing. Pěštany?
Yeah, Pěštany, yeah.
Okay, Pěštany. So he actually has, you know, fragments of embroidery like this in his collection. And the other person that did too was Emily Floga, the Austrian kind of avant-garde fashion designer who was famously a companion of Gustav Klimt. So this kind of Slovakian embroidery was particularly influential for a lot of Viennese designers.
Oh yeah, Slovak embroidery was very popular, and it still is very popular. And they're still reproducing things from time to time and selling it. So
it's gorgeous. Beautiful,
beautiful work. This is from Prigorje, yes, in Croatia. And these people, usually you'll see them pictured with a big laundry basket because their work is they do laundry. I actually purchased this online, believe it or not. And I think it was listed as a Mexican ritual costume. And right away I knew what it was and I hurried up and grabbed it. But it's beautiful and it's a very rare piece, and it's an early example of the Prigorje costumes from Croatia.
This is one of my favorites. I think the weaving and then also the embroidery is just fantastic.
Yes.
Shows this amazing complexity.
And recently I just purchased the man's costume to go with that.
Oh, fantastic.
So your next exhibit, I'm ready for you.
So Marvin, I would love to talk a little bit about this, because this is a really special, I have to say, costume for Macedonia. We included in the exhibition, Macedonia is not part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. They are ruled by the Ottomans at this time. But there are some interesting connections between these countries that are sort of on the, as you say, the kind of, as Megan mentioned, sort of borderlands or the kind of hinterlands of the empire, and the kind of relationships between these different areas, the sort of,
Yes, the Skopska Tsarinogora costume you had mentioned, actually the bridal chemise at the bottom, it's styled after the Skopska Tsarinogora costume, which she mentions in the exhibit. And this is a bridal costume. And again, recently I was able to purchase the rare bridal apron that goes with this. Unfortunately, it wasn't in time for the exhibit, so it'll be again at your next exhibit. this costume is pretty rare. Sometimes with this costume, they would wear the well, the bridal costumes, I say in mass training, they will wear this headdress called a sokai, and it's another very rare piece. And when the bride puts it on, she wears it for 40 days and she sleeps with it up from 40 days to 3 years. And some of these bridal headpieces, when they have a male child, part of it's are burnt, part of it's are destroyed. They're very, very rare. They stopped wearing these in the early 1900s, but a lot of these rare bridal costumes are very hard to find. And especially the sokai, which I have, I think maybe four of them in my collection at this time, hoping to get more if possible.
Marvin, I was going to ask too about the one interesting point about this costume that was the apron. So initially we had an apron that was later.
Yes, I actually put another apron, which I really liked a lot more. And it was, the condition was really excellent condition. I was really happy with it. And I spoke with my friend, Dr. Vladimir Yanevsky in Macedonia, in Skopje, Macedonia, who has a really large costume collection. And I showed him the picture and I said, what do you think? And he said, the apron's wrong. And I said, why? And he said, well, because the motif on it is called aeroplanchetta, which means little airplanes. And he says, this costume dates from pre like 1900. And the apron is probably, you know, World War I, like at that time or later. So he said, the apron is totally wrong for the costume. So I had to remove that and I put this apron with it, which he said was appropriate. So I'm always learning. I mean, I don't know it all. And I welcome advice from people because, you know, you never know who might have heard something from their grandparents or from someone else. So.
And I love that. Yeah. It really speaks to the evolution of folk costume and it's,
yes.
And how much it. That,
that was one thing that I found very interesting also when I was collecting is that during the Ottoman rule, the Ottoman Empire, the Ottoman Turks would not let people make anything that was created by Allah. So you couldn't have, you know, faces, flowers, anything like that in embroidery or on folk costumes, because that was made, that was created by Allah. So in the Austro-Hungarian Empire, it was just the opposite. Flowers, birds, you know, all kinds of beautiful ornaments of all types. And it didn't really matter if it was created by God or not. You know, they were really into beauty and lace and design and stuff. And those were always changing, and we would find something new, a more exciting pattern, they would put it on, you know. So things changed, but within the boundaries of what was acceptable for that ethnic group or that village. So, you know, they were limited in some ways, but then again, they weren't as limited as the people in the Ottoman Empire. So the costumes from the Ottoman Empire, I think, are probably more archaic. And the ones in the Austro-Hungarian Empire have changed a little bit and have modernized and were more living costumes and changing from day to day.
And that has a little bit to do with geography too, right? Because of the...
Yes.
Some areas of Macedonia are quite difficult to access, right?
Yes, yes. Mountainous areas, and yes, that's correct.
Definitely. So we are running a little bit out of time, but I'd love to talk to you, Marvin. One question I did want to ask was sort of how does folk costume in your kind of experience help construct or create community within the kind of Central European diaspora? So people living, you know, in the St. Louis region or in Granite City.
Yes. Do you know, in most of the immigrants, like from Croatia, Czech Republic, Hungary, a lot of them came like in the 1860s, 1870s, 1880s. So most of the children and grandchildren really don't have an idea of what the original costume of their ancestors looked like and how it was worn. So what they did is, in order to have a sense of identity, they would create a costume, a, you know, so-called Hungarian costume. And the Hungarian costume was basically, for the girls, was a white skirt, a vest, and they would have flag colors, you know, Hungarian flag colors on them. The Croatians, sometimes they would go in the 1960s and 70s and purchase costumes from Croatia. And like the Posavina costume, which was the Posavina costume, a lot of them would purchase these costumes and wear them, even if they weren't from Posavina. That would be the so-called Croatian costume that they would have and they would use. Later on, these were hard to get, so people would use curtain material, and they would, with the big flowers and bold designs, and they would make the skirts and aprons out of the curtain material, which actually looked really, really nice from the stage. But they had a sense of belonging, and they would preserve their heritage by wearing their so-called folk costumes. Whenever they have, you know, dance groups, they make these costumes. And when I was a little kid and with the Macedonian folk dance group, again, we had stereotype costumes. I didn't know what an old original costume looked like until I saw Grandma Tasa's costume that I was able to get in my collection. So, and you know, they have a sense of pride, they have a sense of identity, of belonging by wearing these traditional things, and then they're able to pass this down along with food and other things that make up their identity.
Thank you so much, Marvin. That was really beautiful. And I love hearing all of the stories about your collecting. I think we have like maybe a few minutes for questions. We ran a little bit over time.
Okay. I would also like to thank you and all the people at the Art Museum for letting me be a part of this. It's a great honor to me.
Well, we are thrilled you participated, because it would definitely wouldn't have been possible without you.
Thank you.
So I have a few questions here. So I have one question, Marvin, which might be able to answer. It says, were some parts of the bridal costumes borrowed, or were they made specifically for the bride and groom?
In later years, parts were borrowed, like this sokai that the bride wore on her head. They would pass that down from person to person because they were so labor intensive and they were so expensive. And when the war started, people couldn't get materials and things like that. The one costume that I have on exhibit, the woman talks about in her notes, because of the war, it was very hard to get material for the costume and things like this. So parts were borrowed, and later on, even parts were mixed from region to region. So you didn't get, you know, the authentic costume from this one specific region, but you would get pieces, and you know, it'd be more of a national costume for that country, as opposed to a specific, you know, Prigoria costume or Posavina costume, or yeah.
This might be from Megan. So there's a question about, I think this is a reference to the Emperor Homage Parade, but were the Roma or Jewish people of the Austro-Hungarian Empire also represented at the fair?
Sorry, just turning the video back on. Definitely. So those groups would have been represented, but not as distinct ethnic groups per se. The peoples of the empire were represented in terms of the historical crown lands and provinces, and the order that they appeared in the emperor's title. So in other words, Jews were not represented as a distinct distinct group. It would have been Jews from Bohemia or Jews from Galicia, et cetera, et cetera.
Okay.
But yes.
Let's see. This is a question of for Marvin, what are the kind of practical challenges of maintaining a costume and textile collection in terms of
space? I think space for me, definitely. Most of the items that I have are in my house, and I really am running out of space. I really need to do something. And then of course, you know, each one has a special bag, and then I have to worry about, you know, moths. When I introduce new costumes into my thing, I have to worry about if they're, you know, infested with moth eggs or whatever. So it's always a challenge. And then just making sure that I have the right information, everything has a tag, and I'll be retiring soon. So this is gonna be my full-time project. And I was gonna say also in my collection, the Roma, the Jewish people, several of them. I do have costumes and parts from them. If not a complete costume, I do have parts from a lot of the minority groups. That's very important for me to have them represented.
It's from the museum's standpoint. We do try to, as Marvin mentioned, kind of protect our own textile collection. So we quarantine any type of fiber that comes in the doors, whether they be, you know, acquisitions or outside loans. So we put them basically in plastic bags for several months. And then at the end of that, we know that whatever was living is now no longer living. And we can, incorporate them into our larger collection of textiles. So I will say, when we went to visit Marvin's house, you do have many, many costumes. But our conservator was really impressed by the way that you've maintained them, you know, and all the different bags and everything. So I think you're doing a fantastic job.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah, Miriam was a great help with explaining a lot of that to me also. So I really appreciated that.
We did have one question, Megan, which you might be able to answer, or Marvin too, about these other regional governments within the Austro-Hungarian Empire and sort of what their relationship was to folk art. I think the specific question is about the present day Czech Republic.
Is that in the chat?
No, this was from out. This is from outside. This was a question we got before the talk, actually. So it would be a question of kind of, I think, whether or not folk art was influential on these regional arts and crafts movements, for instance, you know, out of Hungary or Prague.
The answer is absolutely. What I got into briefly in my talk was that Viennese curators, the Viennese art historians, wanted to stress the commonalities among folk art from the different regions and provinces and form this supranational design style that would somehow be, you know, patriotic, Austrian, above nationalism. But at the same time, folk art was being claimed by specific regional and ethnic traditions and rediscovered and tied to the ethnicity. So very much folk art informed, you know, the secessions, the secessionists, the modernist movements in the various provinces and in the provincial capitals. And I can say that in Vienna, there was very much a fascination with these modernist variants, and problematically, you know, somehow this art was believed to be more somehow more ethnically inflected than like the idea that all Slavic art is somehow inflected by the folk, by the people.
Interesting. I think we are like up against the clock now. I wanted to thank both of you. We have some wonderful comments from folks who are just saying how grateful they were. And especially Marvin, how fantastic your collection is too, and how thrilled they, you know, are that that you shared them with us. For further reading, some folks have asked that too. I will recommend this book. Oh no, this is not gonna work. I'm gonna put it in the chat. But this is a great book that Megan contributed to, called Women Artists of the Wiener Werkstätte. She's been doing fantastic work. There's also a great book called Textiles, Fashion and Design Reform in Austria-Hungary. And this is by Rebecca Hauser, who I know Megan's done some work with and is a colleague and friend. And Marvin, I think you're actively involved, or you continue to be actively involved in collecting and displaying costume.
Yes, I actually have some Zoom talks from time to time, and I also display at different festivals and different organizations and I talk about my costumes. So anybody needs any information, please feel free to contact me.
Fantastic. Thank you all so much. I really, really appreciate it. This was a delight. And I know we have a big crowd that was excited to hear from both of you.
Thank you. Thank you to all three of you.
Thank you very much.
This has been fantastic. And I do want to let someone asked in the Q&A, yes, this is being recorded. And yes, it will eventually go up on the museum's website and on the museum's YouTube channel. So that will be coming, I'd say, in the next month or so. So thanks to everyone. And I also invite everyone who is watching today, if you'd like, look on our website. We have several more virtual programs coming up next week on next Thursday, February 9th at noon. The museum's Romare Bearden Graduate Fellow Charlie Farrell will discuss the life and work of 19th century sculptor Edmonia Lewis. So I hope you're able to join, and I hope you're able to come see the exhibition if you haven't already. So everyone, have a great day.
Yeah, enjoy your lunch.
Thanks.